today. You must be exhausted and tired of answering the same old questions.
No, it's been a lot of fun. Everyone's been great, and everyone's kind of intrigued by the book just because it's so different in its subject matter, I guess.
It is. Now, the Lone Ranger, in this thing, you have things about the plot to kill FDR. I don't know if that was real or not. With my problem with historical fiction, and I say this every time we have somebody who writes historical fiction, is I have a tough time discerning what's fiction and what's reality. And sometimes that can get me into trouble because I will argue that it's all truth and nonfiction, and that will get me in trouble. So is that part of it a real, the attempt to assassinate FDR?
No, that one's not true. But
See, I would have.
what happened when I was doing the research for the book, and I was reading a lot of newspapers from that time period just to get into the feel of the era. And you never know what you're going to stumble across. And I stumbled across an article when FDR came to Buffalo in 1932 when he was running for president as for his first term. And in the article, they laid out his entire route that he was going to be taking, when he was going to be at the hotel, when he was going to be at the hall. And it just, that certainly wouldn't have happened today with the times that we live in. And I just thought that was so fascinating, but it was right there in the Buffalo News, Buffalo Evening News. And so I incorporated that trip to Buffalo, but then I threw in the assassination attempt.
Interesting. So it sounds like you were in the lot, because I don't think you'd find that Buffalo Evening News articles online, or maybe you did, but it sounds like you're doing a lot of microfilm research and things like that.
Yeah, getting nauseous and the microfiche machine at the Buffalo Central Library.
Very cool. Is that where you're located in Buffalo?
I am located in Buffalo, New York, and the setting of my two historical novels, Rook and Yesteryear, also are set here.
Oh, very cool. Now, but I was under the impression, and this is like I could have wrong, is that Lone Ranger started as a radio show in Detroit, not Buffalo, right? Or
Well, you're almost right. Fran
okay.
Stryker, Fran Stryker, who was the writer and the creator of the Lone Ranger, was a Buffalo writer, and he worked at WEBR radio here in town, which is still on the air today. And he was a script writer, a radio script writer. And as you know, back in the day, in the 1930s, the radio stations had their live dramas and comedy on the air, their own orchestras, their own actors and actresses, and their own writing talent. And so Fran was a script writer, but he had to support about a dozen families that lost everything during the Depression. So, as a side hustle, he was sending out scripts that had already aired on WEBR and was selling them to other radio stations across the country to make a
Wow.
few extra bucks. And he would, charge anywhere between $2 and $7 a script. And one of the stations that was buying his material was WXYZ in Detroit, owned by a man named George W. Trendle. And by the end of 1932, Trendle was buying three or four scripts a week from Stryker. And he, I almost said emailed. He sent him a telegram. I am tired. He sent him a telegram saying, "Hey, can you write us a Western, and put in all the hokum." That was the word he used, hokum, which
Oakum.
is a great word. I want to bring it back.
Yeah, I want to start using it too. That's a cool word. I like
But into that, and then he said, "All the hokum.
it.
Mass rioters, girl tied to railroad tracks, two gun bank robbers. Can you do that?" And Stryker said, "Sure." And he went to his file cabinet and he pulled out a script that he wrote 2 years earlier. It was a series that was airing in Buffalo called Covered Wagon Days. And he, for whatever reason, he chose episode number 10. And he repurposed it and rewrote it and got feedback from Trendle and the folks at WXYZ and came up with the Lone Ranger character. And the Lone Ranger, as you said in the intro, premiered 90 years ago this year, but the premiere was in Buffalo. They did a little test run at WEBR before it moved to Detroit and WXYZ, where it was all through its radio life
Well, you got to admire the entrepreneurial spirit there of Fran Stryker, but I don't think you could ever get away with that. He was like a one-man syndication in on his own without really looking into the legalities of all that kind of stuff, because I don't think you can get away with that anymore, like just selling scripts you had already run someplace and resell it repurposing.
Probably not, but you know, but think of what, like when streaming movies and TV started and everyone was starved for content. That's the same thing that was happening in with radio in those early days, right? They needed something to fill the time. Right. And so they were turning to guys like Stryker for content. But remember, this is 1932, right? So no copying machines, no computers. So he's typing these scripts on a typewriter, manual typewriter, obviously, in carbon paper. And he's trying to strike the keys as hard as he can. So maybe he can get two or three copies, you know, off of one carbon, so he can send it out to two or three radio stations at a time, trying to sell these scripts. So he was under a lot of financial pressure, and you got to do what you got to do.
I wonder if any of those recordings are available from different stations of the same exact script. Did you find out any of that in your research?
Oh, that's interesting. I didn't look into it, but that would be interesting to do a little side-by-side comparison.
Right, different actors, different commercials.
Sure, yeah, all that'd be fun. That might be the next book.
So before I, because I want to get into this idea of the Lone Ranger and where he got it from, and I'm sure you came across that in your research, but what was the impetus for you? I mean, were you a all-time radio fan? Have you been like, is that something that you had been exposed to?
Yeah, I grew up listening to the Mystery Theater on radio with E.G. Marshall was the host.
Wow.
And
you don't look old enough for that. Maybe I missed something here.
Yeah. I was, you know, in the 70s, that was still on the air. Yeah. Wow. And so I used to fall asleep listening to the Mystery Theater. And then of course, Dr. Demento. And you know, I always loved old movies. And then also in the 70s on albums, they started releasing some of the old radio shows on 33 and a third albums. Right. And I bought a few, and I still have them. They're hanging up in my office on the wall now, but it was like, you know, Bogart and Bacall and To Have and Have
The
Not.
Shadow, all those scripts. Yeah.